Microphone here. Welcome. Good evening. For those of you who don't know me, let me introduce myself. I'm Roger Grabowski. I'm the faculty here at Lakeland College, Japan. And welcome to the first lecture of the summer semester 2014. Tonight we are joined by Asgeir Christensen, who, as you probably know from reading the poster and the publicity about him, he comes to us from Denmark. And he's going to be talking about the North Korean abduction issue. So, let's give Mr. Christensen a warm welcome, and then we'll wait until the end of the lecture. If you have any questions, well, we can have a nice time of questions and answers then. So, Mr. Christensen.
Thank you very much for coming in the evening to listen about this actually very old-fashioned issue. I believe someday it will stop being old-fashioned. It will be very, very hot news again. But I don't know when. It might take a long time. My name is Asgeir Røjle Christensen. I understand Roger skipped my middle name, which is actually what I'm... Most Japanese all do the same. But it's actually the name I'm known by in Denmark. I'm an experienced Danish journalist. I was Tokyo correspondent many years ago, I guess before some of you were born, and from 89 until 95. And I have followed events in Japan for 30 years. In 95, I moved back to Denmark. I have had a lot of different editors' jobs, but all the time I have visited Japan and I have followed Japan as well as I could. And half a year ago, I moved back here and took up my career of my youth to start to as a freelance. I established my little company to start as a journalist and analyst here in Tokyo again. I thank you very much to the organizers for inviting me. I'm honored. Two and a half years ago, I had this book published in Danish. It's only 5 million people read Danish. The Swedes and Norwegian, they will be able to read it also. Then it's 17 million, but still it's very, very few people. It's about the abduction issue between Japan and North Korea, and actually several years of investigative research was the basis of the book. It received very, very good reviews, I modestly say. In the Danish media, it was captivating as the most bizarre crime novel one of them wrote. But in spite of that, it did not sell very well. And of course, Denmark is a small country, very few people speak Danish. It had limited impact. So, rather than a book about the abduction issue, the latimundi in the broad sense, it was a book about the lives of one of the abduction victims and her suspected abductors. It's a book about four persons, none of them great personalities, who stumbled into being important pawns in the great cynical Cold War game. Abducted in Copenhagen, it's a story of Keiko Arimoto, who went for what she supposed was a job interview with North Korean representatives and agents in Copenhagen in the summer of 1983. And the following day, she voluntarily flew to Pyongyang. Many years later, in the summer of 2002, at the summit in 2002 in September, the North Korean leader Kim Jong Il, at the time, he acknowledged towards in the summit with Japan's Prime Minister Junichiro Koizumi that during that period, North Korea did indeed abduct a number of young Japanese to North Korea, And Keiko, he also acknowledged Keiko as one of the 13 Japanese citizens kidnapped by the North Korean agents in the 70s and the 80s. First and foremost, this book is about Keiko. She's a young, naive girl from Kobe, and after studying 1 year in London, she was then invited to this job interview, which should take place in Copenhagen.
Thank you.
In Copenhagen, she met with several people. One of them was Kimihiro Abe or Uemoto. He has two last names. He took his wife's last name. He's famous in Japan for another reason. Back in 1970, he was a member of the so-called Yodoko group, which hijacked a Japanese passenger plane to North Korea. I have studied the Yodoko story a lot in connection with this book, and I used some documentaries, Japanese TV documentaries from NHK and TVSI. And here we are sitting in Denmark, close to Christmas, you can see. And my son, who is fluent in Japanese, is helping me understand what's going on. And this is an interview with Kimihiro Abe, who's still is in North Korea. In Copenhagen, Keiko also met with Megumi Yao, who was the wife of another Yodoko hijacker who also lived normally in North Korea. She thought she was a good friend. She had met her in London. She was the one who asked her to come to Copenhagen. Megumi Yao wrote much later, this book, which he very much apologized for having teased Keiko to come to Copenhagen. I know some Japanese after all these years, but I cannot read a book like that. I had a very good arrangement with some Japanese students in Denmark who translated these books for me and got some practice, and in the end I gave them a very nice sushi dinner. but that was very important for me to gather all these materials. And the third person Keiko met in Copenhagen was this guy, Kim Yu-chul, a North Korean diplomat and agent formerly based in Copenhagen. These are the four persons whose lives before in Copenhagen and after this meeting in Copenhagen I tried to trace and who are the main persons of my book. Most likely the meeting took place in this terrible, very, very cheap Chinese restaurant in the center of Copenhagen up here. It still looks the same. Since I was young, it has looked like this. And I would like to read a little section of my first chapter when they come to this Chinese restaurant. The room was dark and gloomy, even on a bright Danish summer evening. Terrifying dragons, cranes, and happiness signs crept up and down all the walls, all in dark red and gold nuances. In the windows, heavy vases were placed and paper lamps were hanging from the ceiling, one classical China cliché beside the other. Already at the time of the fateful evening in the summer of 1983, when Keiko Arimoto visited the Shanghai restaurant on Copenhagen's central walking street, the restaurant with its stone lions at the entrance was a large, dusty China setting. To this day, the decorations at the restaurant are pretty much the same. Keiko was only 23 years old. She grew up in Kobe, in distant Japan, and is quite understandable, she had no overview over where she was. What was north, south, east, west in Copenhagen? She looked out of the window. She looked towards the courthouse and down the street, which leads to the city hall. She was not quite aware where she was. Of course, Keiko was a little wary. She did not like the greasy Chinese dishes, which even then were served in the cheap restaurant. Like many of her fellow Japanese, it seemed to her that there was far too much oil served with traditional Chinese staple food. But she liked the company she was with. She was happy to sit here in this puny restaurant with these amazing people. Deep down, she was well aware she did not know them, but happy she was. Keiko's life had until then been running in a deeply boring groove, predictable and terribly boring, she thought. Now something was about to happen, whatever the cost, something she had decided by herself. The opportunity was there, right in front of her. She stood on the threshold of a great experience. The unknown people around her were her ticket to a future that was more exciting than the life she came from. In Keiko's ears, it sounded like an adventure. They said in all seriousness and offered her a grown-up job with grown-up challenges in a foreign country. Nice people. It did not occur to Keiko that they maybe were a little too nice. One of the criticisms I received from a book was this detail with the greasy food. How could I know? Of course I don't know. It's I took my wife's taste, and my wife is Japanese, and implanted it in the story. But in a way, it's I shouldn't have done it because I have so many details, and as principles throughout the book, I only use things that I have. It's not always with the source on, because when you work with issues like this, sometimes you cannot tell where you got the information from. But it's all these kind of invented things shouldn't be necessary. And I promise you, there are very few of them. I do use in the book, I think you've got an impression already in this section, I do use the techniques, the methods of crime novels in some chapters, not all of them. And the reviewers liked it. Actually, I was invited that year to the Danish Crime Novel Writers' yearly exhibition to make a presentation about the book, and I was a little bit skeptical, but it isn't a crime novel. But I went there, and the publisher, of course, wanted me to go there, and it was fun. This is an amazing picture. This is Keiko, Anthony Mutual, the North Korean agent, diplomat agent, and they are sitting in the gate in Copenhagen Airport just before takeoff, just before they are entering the flight to Moscow, and which will continue to Pyongyang. This picture is taken by the Danish intelligence agency, PET, and because they knew him, not her. They followed him, but they didn't know her, of course. They had never seen her before. So the pet photographers, they didn't know that an abduction was taking place in front of them. I knew, it's amazing that this picture do exist, and I knew very early that I wanted to use it as a picture on the front of my book. And maybe I can send it around. You can, of course, not read it, but maybe you can look at the pictures while I'm talking. Why do this effort and write this book? The abduction issue had an important impact, a very, very heavy impact on the diplomacy of all East Asia for many, many years. It holds East Asian diplomacy hostage because the Japanese were afraid of focusing on anything else in many, many years. And it's for many people in my part of the world, when we have these news stories on the foreign news pages in the newspapers, it just seemed weird. It just seems that this is these Asian, and they are kind of exotic in the heads. But I thought it was a challenge to, at least to make more sense out of the story. That was a major reason for all my efforts here, but also for taking up this issue. Personally, I'm very fascinated by the human appeal of the abduction story. I lived in Denmark in 2002 at this summit when they decided that the surviving abductees should come home, and a month later they came home. They stepped out of the plane in Haneda, and all Japanese were sitting there watching the television at the same time. And this story was dominating the media totally for months. And we were living in Denmark. We had NSK satellite television. We were also following it. But totally, it had a very, very strong appeal. Of course, if I should make, it's actually the largest Danish publishing house that published this book. If I should make them interested in the project, it needs to have this Danish angle, and it had, by the fact that Keiko was adopted in Copenhagen, which is the capital city of Denmark. I have a fascination by this angle on the story that how do these idealists, those people who are the active ones in the story, they are, from the beginning, they believe political thought. They believe that they are doing the right thing, and then they become such cynics. How abductees, some of the abductors might be considered maybe political abductees from the beginning, how they become abductors themselves. Also, we have a very clear picture of, in our part of the world, I think the same as Japan, about who is the good ones and who is the bad ones in the Cold War. But trying to understand the villains of the Cold War is a challenge also. My basic approach as a journalist to everything I do is, what do people know? What do people already know? And then you have this issue, it's always very complicated, or you can choose so many different angles on it, and then choose the angle that opens people's eyes for something extra, something new, something that challenges what they already know. So indeed, this story was an example where I could try myself on this effort, and then try to communicate this improved understanding to my readers in a way that was fun and interesting to read. And then, if you write a book nowadays, it's because you have a wish to give people a good read. I did all this research in this issue, and if I wanted impact, if I just wanted impact, I should make a blog on the internet and put everything on the internet in English, and then it would be maybe I will have much more impact than writing a book in Danish. But part of the reason for me to start out with this project was that I wanted to write a good book, give people a good read. And this had to be in Danish, because it's my native language, it's the only language I can write so well in. I'm not taking sides to this story. I'm really trying to, it's not a book about black and white. There, so many books have been written about in black and white about this issue. And I try to understand all the characters. And when you read, if you can read it, you will see that neither of the figures are really presented as evil people. I try to avoid that. And in doing so, I think the book contains an extra element, an important message about the mechanism of what was in play during the Cold War. My research took several years. It took me from east to west, I was two long visits in Japan. I met authors, family members, NGO and organization people, diplomats, former diplomats, fellow journalists. I met the Danish police and administration sources in Denmark. And based on all this, I tried to make a personal picture of the four main characters, none of whom, I have to admit, I have ever met. This is the scene I described you a little bit earlier when the first of the surviving abductees came home, which had such a strong impact on me and on many of the Japanese at that time. I visited Keiko's parents a couple of times in a very, very traditional home in downtown Kobe. Not many homes have altar like that on the front of the house any longer. Even though it's hard to swallow sometimes the right-wing conspiracy theories of her very angry and agitated father, it's at the same time it's impossible not to feel respect and sympathy for this old couple who have kept fighting for all these years. And I want to understand them, and I believe it's easy to see them. My research also took me to Keiko's old school. Here she is with her old class. It took me to London, where I found the apartment where Megumi had invited Keiko to nice Japanese food and established this close relationship, which made it possible for her to convince her to come to Copenhagen. To this market research job in North Korea. Keiko did not know much about the world, and she did not know much about North Korea, and she wasn't puzzled about being offered a job within market research in a country without any real market. But still, she went there to Denmark. In Denmark, I focused on the activities of the North Korean embassy in the 70s and the 80s. At that time, there was several scandals with North Korean diplomats being expelled because of smuggling and embezzlement with the diplomatic goods. And here, the ambassador guy and one of his staff is coming to the Copenhagen police headquarters because a North Korean man had been apprehended with a lot of US dollars and a couple of empty Japanese passports. It's an amazing photo also that I received from, I think I can say it here, from a retired Danish policeman. And another amazing picture. I wasn't able to travel to North Korea as part of my research, but this is a picture given to me by Takasawa-san. I think the major journalist in this case who have done most research into it, but is also a very, very controversial figure, and maybe he even, indeed, he did play a very faithful role in the story himself. I met him, and he gave me this picture where he was standing with Tamiya, who at that time was the leader of the Yoroko group, so the original hijackers. But these features are only highlights in order to give you an impression that I have gathered a lot of details about the lives and deeds of our four main characters. It made it possible for me to write a crime story based on real events. I wrote it in the local library in the city in Denmark where I lived, at the Nordic Institute of Asian Studies, who were very, very helpful and also gave me some feedback and Asian help from people with deep Asian knowledge. And in the last phase, I was sitting writing in an apartment in southern Spain. I was switching between drama, documentary, chapters written like a crime novel, and then more straightforward journalistic chapters where I was following my own ongoing research. And this was, as I say, in this kind of story, it was a very practical approach because, as I told you before, some information I got from intelligence people, and I couldn't say exactly where I got it from. I promised them not to. So I could include that in the literary chapters and mention the source in another less sensitive connection in one of the journalistic chapters. I promise you that no major source to any information is not mentioned. All of my sources are mentioned in the book, and it gives you a good impression. Where do I know all these things from? In most crime novels, you have a mystery, and you get a lot of confusing information and developments, and then the whole thing is cleared up and in a somewhat surprising way in the end. That's a good crime novel. But this is very different. The main suspense is that gradually the reader's doubt, gradually the reader is beginning to doubt more and more the story I'm telling them in the beginning. They doubt took a place at that China restaurant. Did it take place exactly at that time? Were it exactly those four persons that were present? And in the end, the reader is left with a feeling that I cannot trust anybody. Like my former daughter-in-law, she said when she had read a draft. And maybe that's a very relevant learning from the Cold War. Okay, when I met other professionals and academics and semi-academics and journalists and also the sources to my book, I really felt that I had something to contribute, that I had done a lot of work in this field to the discourse about this issue. But here it was. Danish. Very, very difficult to get out into the world with a book in Danish. You can look pictures, huh? And only that. So after some time, I've tried to get out into the world with this material. I tried to get it published in English. I talked to a publisher, but I wasn't able to raise the necessary money from funds and other kinds of sources. So I haven't succeeded yet in that. I also tried to get it out in Japanese. I think there was not much information in the book that hadn't been publicized in Japan earlier. But my approach was so different. I think I could contribute to the discourse in Japan. But I was politely and repeatedly turned down. There was too many North Korean books on the markets, and some people said it was simply quite difficult to publish the book in Japan. And others were more straightforward. They were telling me the abduction issue is so sensitive. Even a single word, single phrase somewhere that made the victims' families or their supporters react negatively, then the publishing house could get in deep trouble. So they rather stayed away from this issue. At least any new angle, any new way of telling this story, that they were very cautious about that. I have worked with this issue for so long, so I was not surprised at all by these arguments. I still hope my different approach to the abductions could contribute to the debate in Japan, but it is hard to discuss a debate the Rashomon-dai other than through official channels. It is extremely difficult to get new information to the public and to introduce fresh angles on the issue as a whole. There are several untold stories. The main one, of course, is those eight abductees that North Korea has acknowledged they abducted, and in 2002 they told North Korea told Japan they were dead. Different stories about how they have died, not very convincingly proved, and the Japanese side have decided they don't believe in it. So if these eight persons are actually alive or dead, is very, very difficult to touch upon in the public sphere in Japan. Rumor and speculation that not least Keiko and others are still alive and are working as brainwashed secret agents for North Korea, they appear not in the mainstream press, but in the other parts of the Japanese press from time to time. And according to my sources, and according to themselves, I might say, several capable journalists from mainstream media are working hard to dig out this kind of information, but their editors are extremely cautious. Through my research, I heard about another angle to the story about Keiko. The story that her old high school teacher in English should have played some kind of indirect role in choosing her as an abduction victim. And when I asked her parents about this angle, I was very cautious about it, a little bit nervous that they would be angry with me or something. But her mother said, everybody asks about that. But if everybody in the media, in the Japanese media, goes to Keiko's parents and ask about that, why is the idea never written down? Why is this speculation? It's not proved, and she is not the main culprit. It's not illegal to, if you politically agree with someone, say this girl seems to be very naive. It's not, but it could play a role in the explanation why things happened. But it's impossible to find in mainstream media. I only found it on a blog from a local nationalist politician, and I approached him, and then it developed from there. I know that bloodthirsty Shukanshi has been weeklies and has been after the story. They have been in London because this lady was at that time supposed to live in London, but like me, they didn't seem to have found her. And the police have also looked into this story. They dropped it because it's not illegal, as I said, to have played the role that she might have played. But still, I chose this angle as my reason for, in my last chapter, to come back to Kobe, where the whole story started, and try to find the roots of this. The explanation, why does this thing happen, why does Keiko come into this story. And the third untold story that I have touched upon, that I guess there are many out there, is that I interviewed Yodoko as a lawyer for the group of the original hijacking group and their families, about the case that the Japanese state has against Kimihiro Abe, about the guy who was part of the original hijacking and also took part in the abduction of Keiko, according to the version that I start the story, the book with, and the Japanese police believe in. When I visited her and interviewed her, I was not alone. I had with me an NHK crew. I was actually, part of my research was covered by NHK, who thought that it was very interesting that this guy came traveling from Denmark, digging up this old story. So I was there, and I was interviewing the lawyer, and the NHK was also there. She was maybe. She asked my question, but she was very focused on NSK. She really hoped to get out with her story through me. But they never broadcasted anything from the interview. In spite of her points, well, they were not so convincing that she felt herself they were, but they were new. They were new in Japanese discourse, and in the eyes of the Danish journalists, then it was interesting to contribute to the discourse fight in this way. I do understand why Japanese media and Japanese publishers are cautious. But this overdone caution might be part of the reason why many Japanese, especially young Japanese, have totally lost interest in this issue. Obviously, it seems like the stories that come out is just the same old story again and again. Nothing new seems to come to life. Nobody dares that. So that's why I have given the title that Japan is abducted by the abduction issue. It's not my invention. In the book, I quote a North Korean diplomat for saying it, but it's not his invention either. I have heard that many people have said it through the years. And it is a big hindrance for solution of the issue. And to me, it's first and foremost a problem for Japan itself. In many ways, it must be like that. I understand the criticism of the Japanese media's hysteria, but I wonder if other countries, if their citizens have been the ones being kidnapped, wouldn't have reacted in more or less the same way. And basically, there's no point for all the rest of us to be irritated with Japan, because these tension and this focus on this issue will not disappear. Japanese politicians are still very, very cautious in going into any negotiations for fear of the political impact if they let down the families of the abductees. As I see it, part of the reason that the response was so massive was bad conscience. Bad conscience on the part of mainstream Japanese media, the Japanese government, and even the Japanese public, for not really believing these rumors about these abductions when they first heard them. I was here as a correspondent in the early 90s when it was still, it was there as rumors. And I, like most of my colleagues, didn't believe them. It was too weird. It was too incredible, and of course the political agenda of those people coming forward with those stories were so obvious. So we didn't believe it at that time. It's turned out to be a mistake, but I kind of understand why we reacted like we did at that time. Obviously, the issue has been since then exploited by the extreme so-called right wing in the national groups in Japan. And some of the families have more voluntarily than others joined this movement. Here we have a picture of the families meeting Abe during his, Prime Minister Abe during his first period as Prime Minister some years ago. It would certainly be a mistake. It would certainly be a mistake to see the powerful media response simply as a product of political pressure. I think that the human appeal of the story is enough in itself to explain the uproar at that time in 2002 and for many years after that. Who can avoid thinking about how would you react if it was your son, your daughter, that was snatched away in this way? So the issue is simply so stifled, so paralyzed that even though it's 2.5 years ago the book came out, it's maybe almost a year longer than the research was finished, it could be translated now with very, very few alterations. So little has happened in the meantime. That might be an opening in recent months. I don't know why. Time has passed. Abe is, as Prime Minister, is supposed to follow a very hard line. He has built his career on being very connected with the families of the abductees, but on the other hand, he put priority on it. he pushes that something should happen. So maybe that's part of the reason. There's also a new leader in North Korea who is not so connected to the issue as his father was. So when the parents of one of the other abduction issues, abduction victims, Megumi Yokota, when they a few months ago were got the opportunity to meet their grandchild in Mongolia, actually, which has been a very, very touchy issue for years between Japan and North Korea, it was considered that maybe a sign of an opening. There are also negotiations somewhere, not so secret as they were, as they once were, between Japan and North Korea. So at least we can hope that this stifleness and this paralysis will finish soon. And last, I will read another short section of my book. It's a finish of an of a chapter about the whole issue, where I leave the four persons and tell the story about the Rajimundai as a whole. And in the end, I'm interviewing Hitoshi Tanaka, who was the Japanese diplomat who patiently negotiated the summit in 2002, and played a very major role in the developments at that time. I met him. I interviewed him. And after meeting him, I was, as I wrote here, I was actually pretty shocked when I afterwards, in deep thought, walked through the beautiful autumn columns in the nearby Shidorika Fuji Park, Japan's non-political state memorial grave, which honors the dead from the World War. On my right was the Imperial Palace behind the surrounding artificial channel. The man with whom I had just spoken is probably one of the persons who have made the greatest personal effort to find a lasting solution to the unfortunate abduction issue which this whole book is about. Hitoshi Tanaka's subdued words and his sad eyes had made a huge impression. Do not tell me that diplomats do not have a heart in what they are doing. This one case has many victims. The abductors, their families, but also a number of politicians and diplomats. Many have seen their dreams shattered and their careers erased. Regardless of how many political purposes it has been used and abused for, it remains a case with a unique, strong emotional appeal. It's no wonder that it has had such a strong influence on East Asian politics during the last decade. You don't need to be Japanese to understand that. After my research, I feel convinced that this human appeal is so strong that this issue, even though there's not much focus on it at the moment, as soon as some news will come, people will remember. It will be a very hot issue again. You cannot just sit down and wait for the Japanese to come to the senses and start talking about something else. The issue won't be solved before the credible truth about what happened to the 8 abductees, no matter how painful it must be for both the Japanese families and the North Korean authorities. And in the meantime, it's no help at all for the media to not dare to tell what they actually know. However understandable this caution may be, this can only prolong the agony even more. That was my presentation. If you want to come back to me and after, now we have a question and answer session, but if you after that still want to come back, you can find me here. And there is an article about some of these points in a article in this Global Asia magazine, which you can also find on the net.
So yeah, we've got some time for some questions and answers. I think, excuse me, the best way to do this is if you have a question, raise your hand and I can bring the microphone over so that everybody can hear your question. I'm going to ask the first question. Can you unlock your phone, please, so I can take a picture?
Thanks a lot.
Sure.
Yeah, of course. There we go.
Okay, does anyone have a real question?
Okay, first, thank you very much for coming. I wanted to ask, you mentioned Keiko's English teacher might have had some kind of indirect connection to the abduction. Could you tell us a little bit more about that story, about how the teacher might have been connected?
Well, what it seems that many people have had have checked out, have researched into, like I have, is the story that her English teacher in the gymnasium, it was a very political gymnasium, it was in the 70s, very political place, and she was actually, personally, she knew some of the Yodoko hijackers, she knew some of the people, she might have been, if not pointing at her, saying, go after her, abduct her, then say, this is a naive girl, she's in London. Some of the people, including Takasawa-san, I mentioned, he thinks that it's totally incredible that Megumi comes to London and meets her. So, just she hardly arrived, then she meets her, and then they decide her on her as an abduction issue. Abduction offer. Normally, they took a long time to do this. Seemed that they were aiming at her even before this meeting in London. So that's a speculation. And since it started being a speculation that at least some media and some police also looked into it, then she disappeared. She lived in Kobe, and she disappeared. She worked as a teacher in London as a Japanese teacher in London for some time, at least according to the police, and I don't know where she is now. She's an old lady now. This is the story that many journalists have dig into, but only this crazy nationalist politician from Kobe wrote down on his blog. Otherwise, I don't know if you have seen it anywhere. I haven't seen it. I think that's a shame. It might be not true. It might be only a little part of the story, but it's an example of how cautious you are in telling what you actually have found out.
Thank you.
Any more questions? I don't know if this is a question or not, but I just wonder if you or anybody here really has ever had the same thought that I've had. I'm used to having thoughts that are different from everybody. And before I say this, I should make it clear that I've lived in Japan for 30 years, and I've come to love Japan. The longer I live here, the more I love Japan, the more I love the Japanese. And I should also make it clear that when I heard when I saw on TV, I saw the reunion of the abductees, I was moved to tears. I'm just thinking about it, I'm moved again. So obviously it's a terrible thing to have happened. But I never see anybody or hear anybody that mentions that during World War II, according to my information, there were like 600,000 Koreans abducted by the Japanese, brought over here as forced labor, and a large percentage of them died. And then, of course, we're not even talking about the comfort women. I don't even know the numbers of them who were abducted. And how these people can get so excited about... I know how they do it. It's just normal. In other words, Japan is not unusual in this respect. It's normal for the The victim never forgets, but the perpetrator forgets right away. As it never happened. But does anybody else feel the irony of this? That's my question.
I think many people do, and it plays a role. It plays a role in the Koreans' reaction to the story. It plays a role in the rest of the world being irritated with Japan of being so persistent on the story, and it is a factor in that should be in the book. And I have a chapter in my book called "The Big Abduction," which is about this adoption the other way around of many, many, many more people. So I think that it is part of the picture. I agree.
And I can say that this business of abducting these two Japanese seems crazy to me. Where did they get this crazy idea?
I have an interview which I've not done myself, but an American professor did with one of the first-generation North Korean leaders trying to explain why in at least the first generation of North Korean leaders had a feeling of Japanese as somebody you could do this to, better than other people, because they have this hate. They were ingrained with this hate for maybe understandable reasons from the big abduction. So it's part of the picture. I actually regret I didn't say a little bit about that, because to me it is part of the picture. But still, I also think it's understandable that the Japanese nowadays react like they do. And as I said, I think that most other countries would do more or less the same if their citizens were adopted in the same way.
Oh, another question. I'm just curious about how many it looks like from the bigger picture. Like, you know, it's not that many people. And the investment that they made to adopt these people was, you know, doing research, pretending that they're offering a job, paying for the flights, all this engine for adopting a fewer number of people. So what would you say from the big picture? What were the Koreans thinking, really?
Yeah.
I mean, it probably has its roots on hate, right? But what would be really the impact that they were trying to create with such a low scale?
Most of the abductors were abducted in a very rougher way than Keiko was. They were abducted on the street, on the beaches in Japan, and knocked in the head and put in sacks and taken boats. So this kind of teaching her to North Korea was different from most of the other abductions. It is, why did they do it? It's of course, I've circled around that question during all my research. And when in 2002, when Kim Jong-il acknowledged that North Korea did adopt at least 13 names, he said that it was because they wanted them to teach Japanese language and Japanese daily culture, daily habits to North Korean agents, and some of them were indeed used for that. But there are many Japanese speaking people in North Korea who are more politically reliable than these people. Being, they first have to brainwash them. I think that even for North Korean standards, it doesn't really make sense. I'm in my book, I'm subscribed to another explanation, which is based on the fact that the Yodoko group, some of them did actually develop into very, very useful agents for North Korea. They were, of course, more politically motivated from the beginning. But some of them were, and having Japanese, traveling around, being Japanese, in the beginning having Japanese passports, is really the best agents North Korea could dream of. So, yeah, I think that the intention was to brainwash them and use them as agents themselves. The case of Keiko, which is from 83, she is not the obvious choice for an agent. I think that we haven't heard about it. Of course, some people in Japan think that many others have talked. But of the known cases, this is the last one. So maybe they found out, well, it doesn't work. We cannot use them as agents in the history.
Okay. I just wanted to ask, you said that there's probably this ingrained hatred on the North Korean side that allowed them to feel that it was okay to do this. But then you talked about it was these Japanese agents working for the North Koreans who abducted Keiko. If it's all based on hate, then how did they get these Japanese agents to do the work for them?
But they had abducted this airplane. They were ended up in North Korea. They were subjected to very, very heavy brainwash. Some of them didn't manage. They didn't want to cooperate as willingly as others with the North Koreans. Actually, I used a full chapter in my book describing how they lived there in the revolutionary village outside Pyongyang, outside the main city, and they live in a Japanese community. Even though they are supporting North Korea, they are some of them very useful when they send out on missions out in the world. Back in North Korea, they live totally isolated. This idea that they are Japanese will create. So many Koreans are grown up with a very hostile attitude to Japanese. So when the children, after they had school at the revolutionary village in the beginning, when they were transferred to North Korean schools, officially they were North Koreans. They were they were not officially Japanese in living in Japanese society. The returned abductees also told about this living in living quarters and officially not being Japanese. And then two of the couples who survived and came home, they lived in the same apartment complex, they didn't know each other.
Just a very quick question, if I could. I have faint memories, but I came to Japan back in the mid-80s.
Yeah.
And I seem to recall, I lived in Toyama, which is near where one of the the people was taken. I seem to recall media reports back then. I was just curious, when did Japan start becoming aware that this was happening? And how did that awareness grow?
They were abducted in the 70s and the early 80s. The rumors started to come forward in the 90s.
In the 90s?
In the early 90s. That was where some people would think that we should have looked more into it. I regret myself. I heard about it working as a correspondent here. But I think that it's... For a long time, it was the official Japan wanted to negotiate with North Korea. They didn't want this issue to complicate matters. So some person like Keiko's father, he really felt that the Japanese authorities for years pushed them down, tried to keep them quiet because they wanted to politically engage with North Korea in a futile way. And then the whole thing exploded in 2002. It was meant to be a kind of solution. We heard they were acknowledging it. They were sending back some of them, but these were relatively young people. So 8 of them dead, and none of them in a satisfactory way describe how they died. It developed into just making the whole conflict worse. Mm-hmm. So the summit was just success in the beginning. It was maybe one of the major failures of Japanese diplomacy.
was just wondering, what do you think are the chances of any of the abductees that are said to be dead are actually alive?
When I wrote the book, I didn't think they were, but some of these very clever colleagues in mainstream Japanese media who continue researching into it without really being able to tell the story, they seem to believe that it is possible that at least some of them are alive. So it's I think that it's when North Korea now in negotiations are willing to discuss the abduction issue with Japan again, I said, oh, that's dangerous game to play from their side. But it seemed that what they are kind of aiming at, and also making the earth ready among the Japanese to accept it, is that we still not hear about these people, or some other abductees come forward. Some of that some other abductees that we didn't hear about in 2002 will be suddenly presented for the world, and their fate will be be the offer that the North Korean can get. But I don't know if the families, who has a very, 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 very strong lobby group and have a very strong political backing, if they would accept in the Japanese country.
Thank you. Well, first of all, I'd like to apologize because I did miss the first 10 minutes or so of your talk. So I think I've got a couple of little questions, and perhaps a bigger question. One of the small questions is further to the gentleman in front of me, his question about the English teacher. And perhaps I missed something at the beginning, but as I'm assuming that this guy in front of me wasn't late, perhaps I didn't. But Keiko was 23 when she went, but this English teacher was her high school teacher, yes. I understood you to say. So there's a sort of gap of 5 years, I'm thinking, between her leaving school, and perhaps you could address that a bit, or whether they were in
contact. Should I say that immediately?
Please.
But that was part of the reason why I went back to Kobe, and this final chapter is a return to Kobe, because so many things start in Kobe.
Right.
Several of the Yoruko group and their wives and the supporters who moved to North Korea to live together and came from Kobe.
Right.
Came from the same group of people coming from the same schools in Kobe, which was the same school where Keiko went. But Keiko, no, there's no report that Keiko was politically interested at all at that time. But maybe that's wrong.
Perhaps she could have been fingered as somebody who was particularly naive or vulnerable.
Exactly.
But there was a gap of 5 years between her leaving.
But still, they had contact. Still, they have contact. And at least some people told me that this is a possible extra explanation, and it might be wrong, as I said, but it's so much in play among those people who have researched into the issue, and it's so little public. That's the point I made with it today.
Right, thanks. Yeah. And then leading on from that, when you you threw up the slide of, you know, untold stories, of which that's one.
Yeah.
I understand, because because of the abductees' family, so nothing that they can in any way, you said, react negatively to. I think I'm missing something here. That is an untold story because it would be criticizing their daughter for being naive or being
an agent.
This teacher had undue influence on her or what. And the bigger question is at an international level, you probably realize that I'm from Britain, and I've had a lot of visitors over the years and since 2002, and none of my friends has ever heard of this issue, so it could be that they're not keeping up with current affairs but I don't think so. And isn't would you, of course, okay, this happened in Copenhagen, she was in London when she met Megumi. We could think that there might be a bit more interest there because that was the setting. I'd like to ask you what you think the prevailing opinion, well, in Europe at least, or internationally, is it this attitude, well, there are only 8 unexplained, and Japan, can't you just deal with it and get over it? Is this what the prevailing opinion is internationally, would you say? How would you characterize it? Thank you.
It developed into that. My feeling was, I was in Denmark, feeling that I was a foreign editor, so maybe that's not the main best viewing point, but my feeling was for several weeks in 2002, it was a major story worldwide. But then, of course, it disappeared, and the Japanese were obsessed with it for a year and a half, and still stick to it for many, many years. And in that process, it was obvious that the story that was told by in Europe was that it was terrible. But it was also, the Japanese are getting so stubborn, and the Japanese are really spoilers in the North Korea developed nuclear weapons. The outside world wanted to negotiate with them, and the Japanese came there talking about abductions all the time, and even the Americans were very irritated, so the Japanese were spoiling the diplomatic efforts.
Right.
And so that was mostly the story we heard, that this was overblown. It was, and also it was, as I started before you came, that it was a kind of a story about how exotic, how strange Asians react. And my effort, whole effort, no, not only for this book, is to try to make sense of it, try to understand and then communicate that, at least a little bit better understanding than the short news stories give you. So that's what I tried with this story also. But yes, I think except for Megumi Yokota story, which has been a major story in America and then there was a documentary and Bush made it when he was a president, made his case also. Mm-hmm. I think that, except for that, for the case of Megumi Yokota, the youngest of the abduction victims, the human interest story, of course, has played most strongly in Japan through all the years.
Just a few quick questions, if I may. First, are there any reports of, I thought I found something on European abductees, and wanted to ask what that was about. And second, you mentioned that you think in the future this will become a much bigger issue, and I was wondering why do you think that will be?
There are other abductees. There are also a lot of South Korean abductees. Mm-hmm. I guess most of them. There are some abductees from France, from Romania, and from Israel also, that the EU and the European Parliament continues to make an issue of in the UN Human Rights Commission. Japan and the EU together are bringing this issue up year after year, and there has been plans for European delegations going to North Korea I don't think it's ever been realized. Mm. So there is a small angle, but maybe they, like it's has been the case maybe with some of the others also, that they started going voluntarily and then were restricted in going home again, and then I don't know what is these stories. I think that certainly if there's been a Dane among them, I would have had to focus very much on it. But I have kept the angle with these four persons. The day when either the negotiations end with some new information about these people coming forward, or I don't know when it is, but when North Korea collapses, that day will be well. I'm feel certain that it will be a very, very major story again. It doesn't matter what kind of truth that comes forward. They actually died, but in another way than they were told. They survived and lived this and that life. It would be a very, very major story for all those generations who can remember the uproar so 10 years ago. And but I don't know when it will happen. But I feel certain that in the Japanese context, it would be a major story, and maybe the impact on the real important impact on East Asian diplomacy would be. We still have the most dramatic ones left to see. Hey.
Let's give a big round of applause to Asghar for a really, really informative and interesting presentation. Thank you very much on behalf of all of Lakeland College.